has some interesting feelings and comments to say about the recording of the After Hours album.
Yeah,
it was he felt it was actually a difficult and a dark time of the band. And at one point he said to me, "I'm surprised the band didn't break up after that album."
No, I would agree with that. Yeah,
and in my naiveness, I probably don't remember that so much. I remember maybe a little bit of niggle here and there about some things, but generally, you know, I was probably, you know, just kicking back and enjoying the time being in the studio, you know, smoking joints with Glenn Shorrock in the vocal booth next door. Oh, did I say that?
Well, I guess that the thing is that by that time we didn't have a producer, and I was probably taking some of that role with the band. Yeah, and I think that there was a very different way between Glenn and I, and Glenn would have been very frustrated with the amount of time we would take to do things, and my pursuit of trying to get things better than maybe he was happy with things of a certain performance, and I would say, well, I think we can do better there, or it's a bit loose here, or whatever. I would be pushing a lot more, and Glenn is not an analytical guy. He's very spontaneous, and he likes to be, you know, just let's count it in and do it. I remember one of his famous sayings was, why can't we just count the song in and do it? Because often, and you might, it certainly got worse, it certainly got more as we've got later albums, but often we'd be in rehearsal and we might count 1, 2, 3, 4, play it, and then I would stop the band within 2 bars because either we didn't get the downbeat together or something was there. I don't know if you remember any of that, but
I can be a bit like that too, you know, particularly when we're recording, but yeah.
Well, and so Glenn would, we'd say do an intro, and Glenn would be about to go up to the mic to sing, this may so be in rehearsal, and I would stop the band and say, well, no, that wasn't any good. Let's do it again. And we might do an intro 5 or 6 times. And he'd be so pissed by the time he got to sing. And rightly so, because
he just wants to sing the bloody song.
Yeah, all I want to do is just sing this thing. And yet we're spending hours and hours and hours trying to get an introduction. It doesn't matter, Graeham. It doesn't matter. And I'm saying, well, sorry, Glenn, it does matter. And then we would finally get into the song, and then we'd hit the middle eight and we'd have some sort of train wreck. So we stop. And we stop again. And I'm saying, well, that doesn't work. And we have to work out why that doesn't work. Glenn just, you get the so pissed off.
Rolling of the eyes.
And so what happened by the time we got to After Hours was that Glenn tended to not want to be around that, and so
he wasn't there.
If I was doing one of my songs, say Country Girls or something, Days on the Road, Glenn tended to either not be there or whatever. And then when he was working, we sort of got to the point where, I'll produce my songs, Glenn, you produce your songs, and then Beeb and I used to always work together. So I think that I couldn't stand his cavalier not really paying attention to it.
Yes.
He wanted the spontaneity, which I appreciate now, and then he couldn't take part in my pedanticness in trying to get the arrangement really awesome and everything the way it could be, and clever ideas in things. Let's put a push in there. No, let's not put the push in there. We try, it doesn't work. But then when we let's build the dynamic going into the middle eight. And then when we do the middle eight, let's come down for that solo. All of this takes time. It takes hours and hours and hours. Yeah. And Glenn, firstly, he doesn't have the patience. Secondly, he doesn't even see the need for it.
Of course, so
I respect I can't get mad at, I was mad at the time and he was mad at me, but you can't get mad at, if someone can't feel it, if you want blue and they can only see yellow, what can you do? Yeah. And so we said, okay, I'll do my blue over here. You do your yellow over there. And that's what After Hours was. It wasn't one of my favorite albums, I might say, but it's a lot of favorite albums, but it wasn't. So then out of that came, well, if we're going to go on, we need to have a producer. And that's when John Boylan came in and did.
Right. Okay.
And John was the ultimate diplomat. He was a gentleman. He was able to meet everybody on where they wanted to be. He could spend the hours I wanted to spend trying to get
the right guy for the job. He
was perfect. Yeah. And then he would sit over, you know, go and have a meal with Glenn or sit in the pub and have a beer. He would say, okay, Glenn, we're going to do the lead vocal tonight. We might have been working, like with Cool Change, for instance, we worked 3 days on that song without Glenn even being there. You see,
and he wrote the song.
He wrote the song, but it took us 3 days. We tried it as a reggae, we tried it as country, we tried it more rock, we tried it so many ways, and so it took a big effort. And then finally, we came up with this awesome arrangement with the ballad that it is.
Yeah.
But John Boylan had the wisdom to know that Glenn would have been so pissed off that he could never have given the awesome vocal that he's given. But if he'd been part of all that. So we put all that together, and then Glenn comes in and did a magnificent vocal. And
it does. It just sounds like he's walked in and just gone bang, and it doesn't sound like you've gone over and over and over.
Because we had done that without him being there. It needed that.
Yeah.
And if you listen, because Mike Clark, dear Mike Clark, who's passed away now, he was playing bass on that. But if you listen to...
Is that Mike Clark playing bass song
on Cool Change?
Cool Change. So it wasn't George.
No.
Was that song recorded after George left the band?
Yeah.
Obviously.
George didn't play on that, no. But if you listen to how awesome that is, like just the bass and drums, just have a listen to that. But then it took...
That's a revelation, Graham. Thank you. I didn't realise that was Mike. Like, I didn't read stupidly. I just thought it was George because I've got to say...
Peter Jones on piano, Derek,
David
on guitar, and Mike Clark on bass because Wayne Nelson hadn't joined then. But listen to how awesome that is with Peter Jones' chords, unbelievable bass playing, so simple from Mike
absolutely.
Clark.
Look, Peter...
That took 3 days. I'm talking long days to come to that.
Yeah.
Well, and it would never have happened had Glenn been there because he would have been too impatient to, and we might work a whole morning, then go to lunch and think, maybe that's not quite right. Let's try another tact, you know? But everybody was willing. We would have stayed there a month.
To do that, yeah.
If it would have taken a month to do it, we would have been there. Don't know where Glenn would have been, but we would have been there for whatever long it took because we knew we had an awesome song, but we knew that we didn't have the
record. Well, look, you know, a lot of history of bands, when you hear about the making of certain songs, you realise that what an amazing song this is, where 10cc, I'm Not In Love, for instance.
Yeah.
I mean, the video, the making of that song, I mean... the stuff that they went through to end up with that end result, you know, and some of the vocal lines that didn't end up on the
exactly. What about Something in the Air, Phil Collins? Or what about the engineer came with the idea?
That story alone,
don't even have the drums for the first 2/3 of the song, and then it's the most iconic drum recording in the history of the world, and that came out of an engineer saying,
How about we hold it up?
808 drum machine, and then suddenly this incredible. I mean,
and the sound of sound of the gated drums. You know, discovering that sound kind of by accident. Like you can do that. Yeah, you know?
Incredible.
Yeah,
that's the wonderful thing about recording, and that's what I was always in pursuit of with all of our songs. I'm just trying to think.
Yeah.
Like there's just the world is our oyster here. Yeah. I mean, we don't need to rush. We were fortunate in that we had the budget.
You had budgets.
Limited time. It doesn't matter if we get Cool Change together in 2 hours or 2 weeks. It doesn't matter. We're pursuing it because we feel that we're getting closer to. We're getting better than we were an hour ago.
Yeah.
While you're doing that, doesn't matter.
And it's the classic thing of Walter Becker, Donald Fagen, you know, getting whole bands and spending days recording and going, nah, let's get a whole new band and try it again. It's like, you know, and people think, I've had arguments with people on Facebook about that. And then I'm going, well, no, look, I understand the immediacy and the roughness of a live, capturing a live performance. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I still believe that, that even in that Steely Dan of being anal about every little note, they still captured great live performances, Grant.
Absolutely.
You know, Steve Gadd or Chuck Rainey's lines. I mean, at some point, they weren't dropping it in note by note Pro Tools. They were going for not only a great arrangement, but a great performance. And I think that's what you were going for, you know?
Always.
That's the ultimate, yeah.
I remember Gadd talking, I think it was Gadd talking about that when he worked for Steely Dan, how they spent so much time on the nuance of the hi-hat. Like they were talking about one beat in a hi-hat needed to be a bit louder. And he'd never run across this before. I mean, we're talking about one of the greatest drummers of all time.
Yes. Yeah.
And yet they're coming in here saying, well, that hi-hat part, that eighth triplet note or whatever needs to be 5 dB louder.
Louder.
I mean,
are you
joking?
Yeah.
But of course they're right because they can hear this stuff. And I'm not putting myself in that league, but I could certainly hear.
Hear it.
Well, particularly hear what wasn't happening. And so I was encouraging everybody to say,
dig a little deeper.
We can do better here. We can do better.
Yeah.
And of course we did do better. And that's why a song like We Come Back to Days on the Road, what an awesome record it is. I mean,
well, it is.
It's a beautiful recording.
And to me, even though all there might have been a bit of angst going on, sometimes, you know, some of the most creative records, and, you know, let's talk about not go over a tangent, but Fleetwood Mac Rumours, the angst that was going on during the recording of that. But what an amazing album.
What an amazing record.
And the Beatles as well. So
with the benefit of wisdom and age, you can see that that's the way it is. I mean, life is hard. I mean, life is mainly trying to struggle through a certain obstacle to get to the other side. And if you are interested in greatness, if you want to try and get to as good as you can be, you better be prepared for all the shit that's going
to
come along.
Suffer for your art, as it were. Yeah,
absolutely. It will.
Yeah.
If you want to sing, you have to work at it. I mean, I took a lot of years to get the confidence, but then when I decided to sing my own songs, what I thought was, okay, I'm not the lead singer that Glenn is, and I don't have the lead voice that Bieber's got, but I think that on the songs that I sing, and like Unlucky in Love and you know, like Initiation Suite and all the solo stuff I've done, I think I'm as effective and as valid on my lead vocals. And it's interestingly...
Absolutely you are, Graham. Yeah.
And when we did BSG about 12 years ago, we did a couple of my songs. One was Heart and Soul. There was something else. We tried some of the songs that I had recorded as a solo with Glenn singing.
Yeah.
And it just didn't gel. You know, it just didn't have the same...
It didn't feel right. Isn't that interesting? Yeah.
I'm actually doing a better job on these lead vocals than it would have been had they been recorded by LRB and either Bieber or Glenn had sung them. But the questions have been asked as, well, you were a lead singer in Mississippi, which I sang Kings of the World. Why didn't you sing lead in Little River Band? And the reason for that was, it was just my own lack of confidence. Like I just felt totally not confident with singing lead.
And look, it was strangely enough, all my career, I mean, in my first band, I was the lead singer in Rogers Dodgers, and all through my teen years and bands, you know, the cover band that I was in before I just joined LRB, I was singing, sometimes lead vocals. And yet when I joined LRB, I never actually sang. It was probably really no need, but it was probably one of my great disappointments.
I
didn't sing a bit more. I mean, I do remember once singing Curiosity Killed the Cat at the Bondi Lifesaver when Glenn Shorrock lost his voice. God only knows what that sounded like.
But I think you sang the harmonies in Sweet Old Fashioned Man too.
No, only on that video I'm miming. I don't think...
No,
I could be.
I think you are. If you look on the credits, I think you did sing Sweet Old Fashioned Man, one of those songs that you sang. I thought it was Sweet Old Fashioned Man, but anyway.
Oh, right. I know in that video we did, you encouraged me to step up to the mic and sing Darling Pour the Gravy, yeah, Darling Pour the Gravy. And I've got this kind of smirk on my face, you know. That's funny.
No, I'm nowhere near anything like a Mr. Perfect. I've got lots of issues like everyone has got in terms of my own inner life and my own struggles with things. But I wanted to say that you use those inner struggles to inform your work. I mean, if it wasn't for that, all of that, what would I have to say? What would I write about? You know, I mean, and because I've said it in my songs, it's all there anyway. And that's the truth. You know, I mean, I'm saying everything I ever wrote was autobiographical.
It's funny you should say that. I went back and had a look at some of the lyrics of some of your other songs, and I went, oh, I'm starting to read more into them, you know.
Exactly.
Yeah, I'm going,
there was a beautiful quote, and I love this. I'll just look this up because we might be able to use this and say it. I saw it yesterday, Facebook, here. I love this, and I think you'll love it too. If someone ever tells you a certain song is important to them, you should turn it up and lay in your bed and close your eyes and really listen to it, even if it's 10 minutes long, because at the end, you will know that person much better. Ooh. Isn't that awesome?
That's fantastic.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
So that's what I mean, is that like as a songwriter, you think, well, how come that song, my song there, is a favourite of people's, and my other one, they don't really care for it? Or that song's such a big hit, but I don't really like it at all. What am I missing? And this is the thing that I think the record companies and A&R people are missing, is that songs are just a complete personal connection between the artist and the listener. And
yes.
If you've written a song and it hasn't sold anything, but it's changed somebody's life, that's all that matters, because you can't control whether your song is loved by a million people or one or none. But if you love it, that's all that exists for. You write it because I needed to say that, and in saying that, I've been authentic to myself and I've healed myself to some degree. So then goes out into the world and is received by the people that love or are going through a similar thing.
Yeah, it's therapy, isn't it, for you as the songwriter? Yeah.
Well, it's therapy for the world, but it is for the songwriter. And people sit around, you know, with machines trying to write a song, and there's all these analysis about, you know, you've got to do this and the melody's got to go up here, and then there's got to be, you know, 19 seconds before the chorus hits and all this sort of bullshit, to be honest.
Yeah.
Whereas ultimately you just have to express what's in your soul.
Yeah.
And that's all you can do.
Yeah.
You don't try and do anything. You never try to write a hit. You don't try to do anything.
Well, and we all know there are songwriting teams that just pump stuff out for the sake of having a formulated hit. And the thing is, they sound like it, and they're fluffy, and you kind of hear it and you go, yeah, okay, same four chords, same kind of BS, you know, and it's here today and gone tomorrow. Whereas something like Reminiscing, you know, or White Christmas, for instance, are going to be around forever.
Yeah. Because they do what this is that they connect with that person, and they've changed people's lives, you know. Without the arts and without songs, what do we have? We've got nothing.
Well, you're right, and it's one of the things I loved about Paul Keating. One of his quotes is, he said, "Arts defines a nation." And
I think that Paul Keating and Don Dunstan, of course, in Adelaide, they're my heroes, because they got the fact that the arts are the foundation of humanity, and they really are.
Yeah.
And Rudolf Steiner said that as well, that arts are the foundation and should be at the top of the tree, whereas here we put it at the bottom of the tree.
I love these rays we get into there. You realise we started at about 11:30 and it's now coming up to 1:30. So
I'm hoping that people will just enjoy the openness of it and the friendship that we have.
Me too, yeah.
Because what I'm loving is that, I mean, I'm willing to say it, is that when you did depart Little River Band, we weren't on the best relationship at that point. But how wonderful it's been in recent years where we've reconnected and we're able to sit down as mature people, if you like, is one way of saying it.
Oh, it is. It's
and
true.
How wonderful it is to enjoy each other's company and each other's thoughts. And yeah, and I just, you know, I mean, I admire the life that you've had and where, and you're still
vice
having.
Versa. Yeah, I probably didn't see it at the time.
Well, we can't. We're too,
you can't.
We're too young. We're too hopeless. But I'm hoping that people will get something from this more than just, well, I played this and he did that.
Yeah.
This is what the side of interviews I prefer to do. I like to just to say how I'm feeling in the moment, you know, about this. I always like to work out an ending that promotes applause. So with Days on the Road, when he finishes, and there were so many to know, and we've got that, the strings, we've got the bass, we've got that beautiful little outro with a what do you call a slowdown?
It rolls slightly.
Rouse slightly.
Natural
but
roll.
Then it comes, and then a chord. And then, of course, you just want to applaud it because it's asking you, it's slowing down, say, okay, audience.
Well, you're actually drawing the audience in. They go, oh, where's it going now? And oh, what a wonderful finish. And you can't help to applaud that.
And so one thing that LRB always did was always work a long time on getting our endings.
A good ending.
Great ending, because when you finish a song, you want the applause. Well, if you don't finish it right, you're not going to get the applause. And so that lovely ending, of course, came out of the fact that we played it so many times live, and that's how we developed that slowdown. We're coming to our end. Now it's your turn to acknowledge.
I love
the ending that we got that in the studio, which you can't do too much with programming, but I love the way that the band slowed down, just played it together, and then we finished together on the ending.
You're right. I remember my father saying once, listening to pop music, he said, I remember him saying, because my father was a really good musician, a self-taught piano player and a great boogie-woogie player, but he always said to me, how come they're fading out? Can't they think of an ending?
Exactly. I hate fades. I agree.
Yeah.
We've done a few fades in our time, but a lot of our, I think the majority of our stuff had a...
had good endings,
Had good ending. I mean, Reminiscing didn't, but it had that awesome solo from Bobby Vinnie.
Yeah, sometimes it's just... Sometimes you want that just the song, a repetitive groove going, and it feels like you're just walking away. Or, you know, it's like walking down the road and you hear something, but you keep walking and it disappears as you... a nice feeling, you know?
Have you heard the live version of Reminiscing with Farnham singing?
Don't know that I have. I mean, I've heard a few. Is this like a YouTube thing I can find?
No, I'll send it to you. There's a reaction video. This guy. It's wonderful because.
Aren't those reaction videos fantastic?
I love them. Well, that's got the ending that we ended up getting with Reminiscing, and it's got. I'll send it to you. You'll love it. It's just. Fantastic.
I know I played it live with in 98 when I toured with the band, and you had an ending that kind of got into a bit of a jam. Actually, dare I say, got into a ridiculously long-winded guitar solo from a certain person that will remain.
Yeah, well I know that did get out of control. But it did.
Believe me, when you left the band, it was totally out of control.
But when I was in the band, it was in control and it was awesome. And that's what I'm going to send you. I'm going to send you that one.
I've got a video I could play you and you would go, oh, what? It's like 10 minutes. He's still going. So I'm going to play every lick that I've ever learned. Oh, Graeham, this has been a wonderful rave with you. So there we were, you know, we're a second album and we're recording the song. And as I said, I remember it well, sitting in the control room, you know, there's Ross Cockle behind the glass, as it were. You were there, Derek was there in his drum kit. Glenn was possibly in the vocal booth, doing a guide vocal. Yeah. And I remember being really nervous about playing the bass intro because I felt so exposed. You know, there's no click track. It's like, 1, 2, 3, 4, In fact, when I listen to it, I can feel that I actually race. I don't race the notes, but it's not exactly.
No, I can feel that too. That there's a feeling of you just sitting on top of it a bit, like a bit of. I know what you're
and
saying.
And this is the first phrase I play, and because I'm listening to it, and when I've tried to play along with it to redo the part, I go, oh wow! I played the opening line. There. Actually, right on top of it. So when I'm going to do it, I'll actually let that first, because there's no counting, I'll let that phrase go past and pick up the second one.
Well, you see, this was rushing is a thing that, like, jazz people, probably because they're so stoned, play so awesome back on the beat. And I noticed the really awesome players play right back.
Well, normally I do play back on the beat. Derek and I prided ourselves on sitting up right back on it. Once we get into it, we're not budging. Back on, right in the groove, you know.
Right in the groove. But what I was going to say was that, like today, you just cut and paste and just move that back just a little bit and you can do all that. But this business about even with strumming an acoustic guitar, this is where Ern Rose was so important to us, and with our singing, he would always say, pull it back, like it's too on the front of the beat. And so even after many years, you know, with the strumming, if to make an acoustic sit the same as your bass,
you just
want to sit a bit behind the drummer. You don't want to be right on it. Yeah.
We're talking milliseconds here.
We're talking up to about 10 milliseconds. It can
exactly,
be.
Exactly, yeah. That's what feel is.
Same with the vocals, you see, with our singing, that's why we got better by about Sleeper Catcher, in that we were able to sit right back on the beat, and it just gives it more soul.
Oh, absolutely, it does.
It is very challenging when you just got your own thing to do where there's no post editing available.
You're right about, I could talk to you about my experience of recording vocals and producing, maybe, you know, singers and backing vocals. It's amazing how often singers sing and they don't listen to the drums, and they're racing ahead, you know.
I know.
And luckily, you know, if you get a great performer, by the time they finish their singing and walk back into the control room, you've gone to the Pro Tools or Logic and delayed the track of 10, 30 milliseconds.
I know.
Actually sitting in time, and you don't even tell them.
I know. Exactly right.
I get into these raves. I'm playing the bass line, you know, and then in Mason.
Yeah, isn't
beautiful
it awesome?
Line. Ba 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 do 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 do. Beautiful Fender Rhodes swimming around in stereo, you know.
Now, I'm not sure. Did that actually happen on the band track, or was that an overdub? Could you remember?
No, he was there cutting it with us.
He did.
Oh, absolutely. I remember it. Yeah, yeah.
Because
a few of those songs, I remember.
It fades in on the record, doesn't it? His part fades in.
No.
It does.
No, it doesn't fade. Because I play a pickup. Da da da. Boom, ba, ba, da, do, da. He's right on the beat.
Oh,
right
there. Okay. I thought it
he's
faded.
Not fading in. No. He's in. But,
Sorry, the whole intro is fading in.
Well, yeah, I'm kind of really, really quiet building it.
We amplify that.
And then, of course, the shock of the band going, ducka.
Yeah, well, that's the accentuated mix, isn't it? Because we start you really quiet.
Well, you do, yeah.
Getting louder and louder and louder.
It was possibly, and listening in hindsight now, I remember talking to Ross Cockle about that, and he said, because I said to him, you know, one of my great regrets is, when you first put it on, the bass is so quiet you can hardly hear it. And he said, yeah, I think Graeham wanted that shock value. So, and I actually get it now, because what happens is you turn the stereo up to hear it, and when the band comes in, it's like, whoa, it's that shock.
But it's too great. Much. I mean, I'm willing to, it was a great, possibly a good idea, but just completely over the top. It probably started too quiet.
Yeah.
And I think it was just a question of, back in the day, we wouldn't have even had automation at that point in our mixing, would we?
No, it would have been all hands on deck.
So in today, you could draw it on with a pencil and say, oh, well, we'll just try it a million ways, and we could start it louder, and then we could dip it, and there'd be ways of getting that. And in fact, on a remastering, we will get that better because we can then master it in Pro Tools and get the dynamic even better. So it's a gradual... what the problem was, it started quiet or too quiet, and then when the band hit, the band came in too loud. So therefore, the beginning needs to be louder and get that curve exactly. So as when the band hits, it's the next increment up.
Yeah, well, you still have that impact, which is great. Yeah. It was just a bit quiet. I've actually, when I did that, remastered that video and put some...
Yes, I love that video. That's awesome.
But I do too. Every time I watch that, I'm quite emotional. And I went, wow, you've actually nailed something here with the dreamy, with the rain falling across the lens. And I've got a slight, what they call a video echo where there's, anyway, I'm having fun with Pro Tools. But one of the things, because I synced the original recording to replace the distorted mono file that was on the VHS, it's now got its original stereo file. And I was, because you can in Pro Tools, you can get into the audio, and I actually raised the beginning a little bit.
Yeah.
And so I kind of raised to a bit, and then I just kind of ducted. Then I actually bought it slightly down, I raised it enough so there was a thing, so there was still a difference in dynamic, which is exactly what you're talking about. Yeah. Still to get that impact, but just raising the beginning a little bit, not too much.
Awesome.
So anyway, I'm doing that. We've done those chords, and those chords are great. Those are, they're like an A minor, then you take your little finger off the chord, so you're barring across. It's like stacked fourths. It's an A minor.
Well,
A minor seventh with an add nine, I think.
Well,
and then you slide it up.
Can I just say, Roger, is that not C add nine over an A? Is that
C add nine is like an A something. So it depends what you want to call it. It's like an A11.
Oh, it's the same chord, is it?
It's the same chord. It's just how you write it in slash form.
Yes.
So a C added nine of an A bass is an A11, I think.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's the same thing. And then you go, baka.
Well, and so that's what I repeated it years later in reminiscing, where I just came up. I've hurried up, you're late. I can hardly wait. Just up three semitones.
Yeah.
So that goes up to the da do.
Goes up to the C. Which is called an E flat add nine.
E flat nine, add nine over C. Yes.
Yeah, which is like a C11 chord, I think. Geez, don't quote me on that. I might be wrong. So look, all those things, and
it sounds complicated, but on a guitar, because you're just using bar chords, it's very simple. I mean, really.
And I've been noodling on those chords. I go, right, it's like stacked fourths is what Donald Fagen talks about, his love of stacked fourths in those chords. And anyway, getting into another road. So getting back to the song, Glenn starts singing, and it's just so. Oh, what's the word?
Heartfelt.
Heartfelt. I remember. Yeah. It's like, trying to get somewhere.
And I think, that remains, I know it remains a favourite of Glenn's. I mean, we did it when we put BSG back together in years ago, but it was one of Glenn's favourites. And it's because it's talking about his life too, you see.
Yes.
It's not like he has to sing something that he
can't relate to.
No, it's absolutely it's his life there.
Yeah.
And he sings it with a great, beautiful
heart. Oh, you do. He absolutely, I've had singers, in the studio and suggesting, you should sing such and such a song. It's a great song. And they go, Roger, I can't relate to the lyric. And if I cannot relate to the lyric, I can't give a heartfelt, passionate performance. That was a lesson for me,
this is exactly why my song Lady, which I had written before Little River Band, never made it until Sleeper Catcher, and it was because Glenn didn't like the song. He couldn't relate to the lyric.
And interesting.
So I presented it for the first album,
yeah,
second album, and Diamantina Cocktail, And when we recorded Sleeper Catcher, which had Reminiscing on it, which also nearly missed getting recorded as well,
we were
one song short. And the producer, John Boylan, said, I think we should record Lady. And Glenn said, I don't want to do that. And he said, well, we haven't got any other songs. And I remember Glenn saying to me, as he walked out to do the lead vocal, you know I hate this song, don't you? and what could I say? But, of course, in his wonderful professionalism, he went out and gave it his best shot and one of the biggest records we ever had. You know, yeah. I was going to say a minor miracle, dare I say a major miracle, that those two songs, which are Reminiscing and Lady, which are our biggest two songs, that they ended up on the same album. But that's once again, I mean, I respect Glenn for doing it, and I respect the fact that he doesn't necessarily like the lyric. Yeah. But in a song like Days on the Road, it fit him like a glove, and that's his...
Yeah. Oh, you can hear it in his delivery. Yeah. When he sings, I almost died there. And yeah, I bet he's relived the, you know.
Absolutely. Screaming it from the depth of his soul.
Yeah.
But you see, Glenn's songs, he's not that comfortable with, if you like, saying I love you out loud. And I remember Sinatra saying once that he never really liked a song that said the lyrics, I love you. He didn't like that. Yeah. He liked it to be more distant, I guess.
Yeah,
and so with Glenn needing to sing a song like Lady, which is just openly very romantic, that's not him, you see. And I understand that. But he was the lead singer of the band, and that's just the way it was. And I was very fortunate and grateful that actually got recorded at all.
Yeah.
But that's just the way it is. But with this one, no problem, because Glenn...
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Glenn was there with it.
Look, I have to say briefly that as a session musician, you learn to do that same thing. You know, you walk in, you don't know what you're going to do, and someone says, I want you to come and play on my demo, and you're being paid for it.
Yeah.
But you're sitting there looking, listening, and you're thinking, this is a really bad song. You have to kind of be professional and go, look, I'm going to give it my best shot. So you have to kind of draw from some emotion to give an emotional performance.
Exactly, because you're not a machine. That's exactly right.
Yeah, but you have to. And you know, I think, anyway, it's funny you should say that about you. And I can just see Glenn saying, you know, I hate this song, and then walking out and delivering a great vocal.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But that's what band life is. I mean, you have an argument with your partner from time to time. I mean, you know, I can't stand you doing this and this, but I love you to death. I mean,
well, I love you.
That happens.
Yeah, now come here and give me a kiss.
Yes. So that was an interesting experience in the rub between Glenn and I, but I think we're on very good terms today. You know, it's we can talk, and he's in a great place, and
he is not. I digress again. I'll get back to Days on the Road eventually. He was interviewed on 3AW Sunday morning with Darren James for an hour from 9 till 10.
Okay.
And I often listen to that, because Darren James always interviews a great politician or a great muso, you know.
Yeah.
It's like you just lie there. And he said, oh, look, and I remember him saying, oh, look, coming up at 9 o'clock, I'm going to have the great Darrell Braithwaite. I thought, oh, this will be great. And then at 9 o'clock, he plays a Beatles song. And I went, oh, that's weird. And he said, oh, I'd like to introduce the great Glenn Shorrock. So I don't know what happened between 8 a.m. and 9, whether he couldn't get on to Darrell. And he's rung Glenn. And Glenn did this fantastic off-the-cuff radio interview.
Awesome.
It was great. And he was talking about, he was talking about how he wrote Cool Change.
Yeah.
How he wrote Home on Monday.
Yeah.
Sitting in I don't know whether this is true or not, but if it's not, it tells a great story. Sitting in a motel room in Las Vegas Hilton with Briggsy, probably indulging in something at the time in the room.
Yeah, that's all true, yeah.
Yeah, and he rang Joe and said, can you guess where I'm calling from? Yeah, well, oh, the Las Vegas Hilton, yeah. And meanwhile, Briggsy's scratching down his conversation.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Brilliant. Anyway, days on... Let's get back days on the road. This is hilarious, Graham. So look, all right, so we've got into the first line of the verse, you know.
After two hours.
Yeah, after 2 hours, we've got the intro done. Oh, dear.
Oh, God. So
what else are we going to talk? Well, obviously, you know, some of them, I think everyone really stepped up to the plate in the song. I think Derek's drumming on this is fantastic. It's really tight. We really lock in. And I love his, in the flute solo, when he plays,
yes.
Of course, he's Tom's, you know. I love having
a drummer who plays the song as opposed to plays the drum.
Oh, he does, yeah.
And very few drummers do that. I mean, Ringo was the master of it. I mean, his what he gave to the Beatles with the way he played the song, whereas most drummers just, they don't listen to the song. Yeah. I experienced it the same when the years that I had Steve Prestwich from Cold Chisel, who was a wonderful songwriter, when he was playing in LRB. It was just incredible because he's playing the song, the feels, and Derek was the master at that as well, in that, like, he's not Steve Gadd, but he can play so effectively on a song and plays the right, his sense of arrangement in a drum part.
Well, look, that's...
It's not just fills and it's where the
no,
kick
it's is. Not.
It's what you leave out. You know, you might put a kick,
yep.
there'll be a push there, but Derek wouldn't play one note or one hit
that wasn't you didn't necessary.
Want. No, yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very, very, very great drummer in that way.
You're right. So it is, in some ways, it's an emotional, but it's a very controlled performance from everyone, but still really heartfelt. I mean,
yeah.
The way Derek and, well, both of us, Derek and I, really lock in on that, man, there's no, you know, we've absolutely agreed where the center point is, where we're going to land with our kick. And I love where, you know, sometimes he does a fill and I don't. I let him play the fill and just swoop down to the downbeat. Sometimes we play a lick and a bass fill together.
Yeah.
And I love how in the last verse, our bass line is slightly busier, where I would play boom, 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 boom.
Yes. And
it's the only time it's, other than that, it's just like doom, doom, as opposed to boom.
And does he put a double kick on it?
Boom. Yeah. He plays it with me. And it's
therefore that would have been, you would have agreed to, between you,
oh,
to do
absolutely,
that.
Yeah. We would have.
It wouldn't be just off the cuff. That would have
No. It was very much discussed as it's that great thing, you know. It's like.
You see that they are the things that made LRB a great recording band, because it was like with our vocals. We'd never do two choruses the same. There'd always be, let's do a, instead of going up, let's go down in this chorus, or.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Things like that. Let's put a hang there, or let's push that note. And then just let it, and then come back in there. These are the things that we spent a lot of time working out. And it wasn't just as a band, but there would then be, between you and Derek, you would sit down and think, okay, now we're the rhythm section. Let's just run this just on our own.
Yeah.
And let's do this, you see. So that's going on.
Yeah.
While I'm talking possibly about vocal parts or considering guitar parts or things. So there's all this thing going on, and we had, you know, may I say it with the greatest respect to Glenn, we had a band of perfectionists that were all trying, other than Glenn wasn't of that, he wasn't had the same interest, but all the players were totally obsessed with getting the perfection out of the performance that we could give, and to be soulful with it as well.
Absolutely.
Not just being without soul, trying to be soulful, but let's really be intelligent and see how clever we can make this and how simple we can make it, which is requires the greatest cleverness.
Yeah.
To be simple.
Absolutely. I mean,
it's the hardest thing to do.
It is. One of the great things I loved about LRB was that attention to detail. And because I'm a bit like that myself, and I've kept going with that concept of recording. Well, you know, let's just, you know, I hate this modern style of recording. Look, you know, the guitar player comes in, I'll give you a whole bunch of solos and you sort it out. Way. I go, no, I'm not going to spend the next 2 days editing. Let's go for greatness now.
Yeah, yeah.
And I still record like that. When I go bass, I've sat here, go do that take. Sometimes it comes very quickly.
Yeah.
And they're usually the best takes, the ones that are really quick. And yes, I can drop in to fix a couple of notes, but sometimes when I'm fleshing a song out, I'll do a take and I'll just sit there and I'll go, look, that was 98% great. Yeah. You know, and I'll pat myself, that was fantastic. It was great, but I didn't like that and I didn't like that. So I'll just reach up, quite happily reach over and go, delete, enter, bang. Let's wind back and do the, because I'm going for a performance.
Performance.
And not a cut and paste, you know. Now,
isn't it incredible that something we recorded and then you took that little double kick thing that you were talking about, you did that over 40 years ago, but it remains a thrill when it's rediscovered. You see,
exactly. Well,
because you get the fact of how wonderful that little moment is there in that that double kick when you say that was only the one time in the song that we did that.
It ever appears. Yeah.
You might be the only person on the earth that even picks that up or remembers it. Yeah. But how awesome is that?
It's
like the bird in the forest building the most perfect nest that nobody will ever see.
Yeah,
but it exists.
Yes.
And that's what I love about it. And I think the whole Little River Band catalogue, you could almost do an hour on so many things that were magical that only we know how awesome that was.
Yeah.
People don't know. But I listen to sometimes some of our old recordings and I think, God, that was great. Like
I do too. Really,
because we put the work in. But it was just that we found an answer and we found a little gem, a little diamond, as you just talked about there, and how thrilling that is. But don't think that there are other people. There might be a kid in his bedroom somewhere and thinks, God, that is incredible what the bass player and the drummer did at that point. How did they do that? It can be that these things are inspiring to people that do get into this sort of stuff.
Absolutely. Look,
like we do with Steely Dan and the hi-hats and things.
I know. I still listen to Beatles and I go, oh, I never heard that little thing that they do there.
And it's thrilling, isn't it?
And I know doing these isolated bass things that it's been a journey of discovery for myself. And by the comments, people are going, wow, I never realised what was going, because I've actually discussed these things and pointed out to people, you know. It's an absolute thrill, and of course, getting back to the song, but Rick Formosa, guitar playing, his tone, his because there's two solos. There's the first solo is guitar, which is where the bass intro appears again in the song. How cool is that?
Yeah. You know?
The song starts with something that appears later in the song.
Well, I think I couldn't be certain on this, but I think that the intro came about because of what you played in that middle.
You see, and
I think I probably could have said, Roger, let's make that because I often do hear things like that and say that'd be a great middle eight. That'd be a great intro that you.
And whether the song initially when we were playing just started off 3, 4, straight in like that, which is a very valid intro.
Yeah, it would have started like that, but then you played that, and I'm saying, okay, let's make a bit more of this.
Yeah, so it's Rick's solo at that point. I mean, it's just
that bend.
I know his swoops and bends, how he bends up to notes, the way he goes, and. He's like he's got this giant rubber band.
It's like he's wrestling
a snake or something. I mean, one was playing guitar like that.
But no one plays like that
now. No one still plays purely guitar like that, you know.
Yes, it's a very unique
style.
To have Rick, and then, of course, wow, his strings.
Well, that was the next thing I was going to say. His string arrangement.
And a conducting. He conducted the strings as well. And
See,
we were blessed to have that because even back in the 70s, I mean, I don't know many bands were doing as much orchestral work as we were doing with strings and things. I don't know how many bands were doing strings.
They probably were, but, you know, Hard to know. God, I'm looking down here. I think we've actually pretty much passed. I've wrote a lot of notes just thinking about this, you know, and when I think we've actually pretty much touched on and more even of all the things that questions that I wanted to ask you about it.
Yeah.
I think we've covered. We really have.
Probably I was thinking about, we got Rick, but the acoustic guitar probably would have been overdubbed. I would have.
Oh, the acoustic guitar. Yeah, absolutely.
Steve and I would have played
together. The acoustic
together.
Guitars are beautiful. And of course, there's some electric stuff in there as well, you know.
Yes, I can't remember any. I would have probably just played acoustic, but I know that in those early albums, Bebe and I used to play in a booth together, and we would strum because I used to flat with Bebe, and we, apart from practicing our vocals endlessly as a duo thing in practice at home, because he was left-handed and I was right-handed, we could mirror each other, and so even our strumming, you know, people don't realise that we would consider, okay, if he's doing a downstroke, I'm doing a downstroke, and if he's doing an upstroke, I'm doing an upstroke. Yeah. So where when you've got that going on, where you're concerned that you're strumming together with the right dynamic, up and downstrokes and things like that. We used to discuss all that, and we worked on all of that for years. So when we picked up two guitars and we'd play a song, it'd be like two guys just in absolute sync.
Absolutely in sync.
Just doing our thing. So when it came to playing that rhythm for Days on the Road, we just had a natural lilt that the two of us could do together.
Yeah.
But then by putting two of them, it makes it thicker than just doing one acoustic.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I would think there's at least two acoustic guitars on it, listening to it, and probably you and B playing acoustics. I suspect that it's you and B playing electric rhythm parts and also Rick playing beautiful rhythm.
Yes.
Particularly.
There'd be three electric guitars and two acoustics.
Yeah, I reckon, absolutely. Yep. And Fender Rhodes as well. And of course, not only Rick's lead, but his beautiful in the flute solo.
Yeah.
Where he goes, do, go, go. Beautiful, man.
Those seconds.
And of course, your arrangements of the harmonies. Sometimes it'd be a single line, then it would be a double with Beeb, and then bang, the three part. You know, beautiful.
Keeping it interesting, and rather than shoot it all in the same one, it could have been the whole three, and I wait.
Yes, it could have been. Yeah,
that once again, I arrange vocals the way an orchestra can arrange.
It's orchestral,
single violin, and then you bring the whole string section.
Yeah, you don't have a 40-piece orchestra all banging away at fortissimo all for the whole song.
And I loved the two part between Glenn and Bebe. That's a nice blend. That's one thing that we had.
Yeah.
And then when I added, it becomes something else. You've got Glenn's solo voice, then the two of them together, and then Bebe doing "And I Hate It," which is
Bebe singing "And I Hate It" out of the blue. It's like, whoa.
So there's a lot of dynamics within the three voices that we can get with that arrangement. Yeah.
Wow.
Well, I love talking about old times, but I do love talking about the music and the things that I know that what we experienced as a band and as people was unique to us, how much I value that experience now as I'm getting older, how much I revere what I was lucky, just fortunate to be part of. It was just what an incredible opportunity to be in a beautiful studio, world-class studio, with just wonderful musicians, and having as much time as you wanted to come up with something. And it was just what a joy.
I know, mate. We've in some ways we're really lucky. You know, I think all I've ever done as a young boy, I've just followed my dreams. You know, and they've just taken me. I've just followed my dreams almost blindly, and it's just led me on this incredible musical journey, you know.
And you're still dreaming.
I'm still dreaming. I
don't know when people will get that. That you can have just the courage to follow your dreams. It won't lead you nowhere. It will lead you somewhere.
And well, it will.
Really, most people don't go there because they're fearful or they've got commitments or whatever. But no, we were blessed, and we are blessed.
And I think at the same time, without being boastful, I think we both recognize that we had a talent.
And we were blessed with this talent,
you know. I mean, I knew exactly what I wanted to do when I heard the Beatles when I was 10 years old. That's it. I'm going to be a musician. Yeah. I want to be in a rock band and I want to tour the world. Yeah. And, you know, well, my dreams have, to a degree, pretty much have been answered, you know.
Yeah, and it is sad that many people don't have that insight into themselves. And I think that's where we are blessed in that there was a clear door for us to walk through and we – we're willing to, well, you worked very hard, I worked very hard. We're willing to put the hard yards in.
It hasn't been easy, you know.
And it hasn't been easy, but it's been wonderful. Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. And you know what? As they say in the classics, I wouldn't change a thing.
No, me neither.
Yeah. All right, Graeham, thank you.
Thank you, Roger.
Thank you, Graeham, and I'll see you on the flip side.
Thank you. Bye.
Okay, bye. Woof. Wow, that was fantastic. Certainly learned a few things there about the song, and it was almost a lesson in life from Graeham Goble. Thank you. Yeah, wonderful insight into songwriting. So without any further ado, I'm going to play this bass, my 74 jazz bass that I actually played on the original recording when it had frets. So now I'm going to play it fretless for you. So you'll have to excuse any clicking and popping. I've got construction going on next door and I think something's being picked up in one of my devices, the old crackle, but you'll be right. It's rock and roll, it's live, baby. So here we go. Wish me luck.
I knocked the microphone. Never mind. Missed a couple of little things, but generally I think I did all right once again. Sorry, I had my head down, I was concentrating. It's all the subtle shifts and all the little nuances. I didn't realise all the little things that I did in the song. Look, it's pretty obvious what I played, you know. Obviously, I get to play a little bass solo at the beginning. So it's very, very simple, but just sets the groove up. The piano comes in, Ian Mason playing that beautiful stereo Fender Rhodes part. And then, of course, all hell breaks loose when the band comes in on that. There, look, you can see all the licks that I played. There's the, which one was it? I added a couple of extras, but generally it's stuck pretty close to it. Rock and roll, you're a heart homebreaker. That lick, and of course the... I've been really enjoying playing fretless of late. I should be doing more of it. Oh, look, it's great listening to it under headphones. You know, once again, Rick Famosa absolutely shines on this track. His guitar solo is just blistering. It's soulful. The way he bends his note, he kind of bends out of notes and bends into notes. It's wonderful. And his beautiful romantic... I should take my headphones off. His beautiful romantic... string arrangement, it's just absolutely wonderful. You know, Glenn's vocal, superb. I think actually the band was a well-oiled machine at this time. You know, we'd been together for over a year and we were really well played in. I would imagine that song would have been played a bit before we recorded it. You know, Ross Cockle pulling some great sounds. I think the drums sound actually really cool on this song. The toms in particular, I like Derek's fills. And of course, those beautiful harmonies from Beeb and Graeham, you know, when you listen, the way they're layered and stacked, it's, the way they weave in and out. And I do like Beeb's opening line into the bridge, and I hate it. That's Beeb all by himself. And then the blistering three-part harmony. Not a bad little band, you know? Anyway, all part of my history, and it's great to reconnect with Graeham like all these years later. You know, there's been so much water under the bridge, and you know, I think I'm actually communicating better with Graeham now than I ever have. You know, I was a pretty young dude back then. I was 21 years old, you know, and Graeham was an established, successful songwriter. You know, I mean, man, they all were. Yeah, Beeb and I were the, it's not Beeb, sorry, Rick and I were the young guys in the band, you know. Anyway, I'm waffling on now, raving on, because I'm really passionate about this stuff, as you can tell. So on that note, I will say... I'll say good night and see you on the flip side. Bye for now.